good morning, soon to be good afternoon. I want to welcome all of you back. It's so great to see so many people come out for the Business and Leaders Luncheon. I want to introduce myself. I'm Lynn Snodgrass, the CEO of the Best Darn Chamber in Oregon, soon to be the Best Darn Chamber in the Pacific Northwest. And for those of you that are new, that would be Gresham. We do appreciate you taking the time to come. I want to make sure that our sponsors are well recognized, so I want to start off with that. I want to thank our presenting sponsors, Portland General Electric and Riverview Community Bank. Kathy, thank you for being here today with Riverview. And I want to thank our education sponsors, Gresham Barlow School District. Our media sponsor, MetroEast Community Media. Marty, thank you very much for bringing a whole table of people here today. Was there any particular reason? Rockwood, there we go. This is a little hot. I'm bouncing all over the place here. There are flyers, as you leave today, there are flyers that show you when the rebroadcast of this event will take place. So be sure and pick one of those up and share that information with your friends and neighbors so they know what's happening in Rockwood as well. We'd like to recognize the elected officials that are here today, and I will forget somebody if I try to name them all. So if you're an elected official, would you please stand and I can recognize you from here. Councillor Hinton, thank you. Shirley Craddock, thank you very much for being here, both of you. Do we have a school board member that is here from any school district? Fire, water, PTA? Okay, thank you. We also would like to recognize our board members that are here today. Warner Allen, the past president of the chamber, Warner Allen of LLP. And Corey Price. Corey Price, I hardly recognize you. Corey Price, would you please stand and be recognized? True, thank you. He's from Gresham Grocery Outlet. I have an amazingly good board. I want to show you something. Do you remember these? We used to use these in the springtime around here. We haven't had a need to use these, but I did on the way up here, and I was so grateful to be able to use these. We use these when there's something bright and shiny going on outside. Well, what is happening in Rockwood is also bright and shiny, but we don't want to hide behind sunglasses to talk about what is going on there. There's a lot of activity going on in the Rockwood area, and I don't think there's a single person in this room or in our community that isn't excited about the excitement that's going to take place in the Rockwood community. So that is the topic today, and I'm not going to introduce the speakers, but I do want to introduce the president of the Government Affairs Council. He is the owner of PDG Construction Services. Please welcome Brian Lessler to the podium.
And I realize I just got promoted to president of the council, so that's great. Did I get a raise also?
Oh, yes, twice of what you're making.
Awesome. Well, it's great to see everybody here. The focus today is Rockwood. As our CEO told you, energy, effort, and excitement are just three words describing the activity and focus in this Gresham neighborhood. We have two really interesting speakers today, and Brad Ketch is the president of the Community Development Corporation centered in Rockwood and also managing partner of Sunrise Development LLC, as I understand it. He's a Northwestern University and Kellogg School of Management graduate, a very smart guy with a deep background and a broad business experience. So I think he has some very interesting things to tell you about the property that they have acquired and the development plans that they have within the Rockwood community. Truly catalytic type of work. Our other guest today is Brad Ketch, and I understand. I'm sorry, Josh Fuhrer. There's two Brad Ketches here. Sorry about that. Josh Fuhrer is executive director of the Gresham Redevelopment Commission. He's also a prior commissioner for the city of Gresham. He's also the president of Ariston Development Company, a very smart guy and a personal friend. I'm honored to welcome him to the podium first. All right.
Thank you, Brian. Thank you, Lynn. Thank you all for being here today. I was here, what was it, Brian? Was it 2 years ago?
Gosh,
I want to say it's gone by fast. Talking about a nascent project in the heart of the Rockwood Town Center. And I'm really pleased to be here again to give you an update on our project and its progress and some exciting news coming up here in the next few months. So as you all know, Rockwood is a neighborhood in West Gresham that has undergone tremendous change over the last 20 years. Some of it not so positive, some of it actually very positive. And we're about to write a new chapter in the history of Rockwood that is, I think, its most exciting chapter yet. So this is gonna be a little hard to see for some of you folks in the back of the room, but everybody familiar with where Rockwood is in the west side of Gresham along 181st, where Burnside and Stark come together is the town center. There used to be a Fred Meyer store right along the Max line there, if you recall, if you've been around for as long as I have. That's not there anymore. The city acquired that site about 11 years ago and have been trying to redevelop it ever since. And as we look at the future of Rockwood and some of the challenges that we find there, and just to highlight a couple of those, Rockwood is actually Oregon's most economically challenged neighborhood. It also has some of the most significant healthcare challenges in the state. As a result, there's a tremendous need on a variety of levels. And so instead of trying to take this really catalytic, pivotal site in the heart of the town center and plunk something down that that worked somewhere else that might fit sort of the mold of what we think of when we think of new development in an urban context, we actually took a step back and we said to the community, what does this town center want to be? What are your aspirations for Rockwood? What are your hopes and dreams for what Rockwood could become in the future? And so the city, my team in the Urban Renewal Agency, we spent the better part of 2 years engaging with the community, really doing a deep dive into what the community would like to see for itself. And actually, this is a process that's gone on really since the city acquired the site 10 years ago in different iterations. But we took a different approach. We brought on a number of what we call community liaisons, actually with the help of the Rockwood CDC and Brad's group, and reached out to people of color in the community that the city historically has not done a very good job of reaching, found leaders in the Arabic community, the Somali community, the Hispanic community, the Russian and Slavic community, and brought them into the fold as leaders in the community, in each of their communities, and worked with them to have them become advocates for our project. And what that did was it allowed us to get really rich, deep, diverse perspectives on Rockwood. Now Rockwood, if you're not familiar, is actually almost 50% non-white. There are over 70 languages spoken in the home. It's a very diverse neighborhood, one of the most diverse neighborhoods really in the state. So getting a broad cross-section of feedback from the community about what the future of this place looks like is really important. And as a result, the project is designed around what the community told us, the feedback that we got. And time and again, the feedback that we got was really around a single common theme. The common theme is really around creating economic opportunity and economic empowerment in a community that desperately needs an economic shot in the arm and a chance to lift themselves up and make something that will serve the local community. So our project, overarching goal of the project is really to create economic empowerment and opportunity in Rockwood, and every component of the project that I'll talk about in a minute feeds into that common narrative somehow, somehow very unique. So just a quick overview, as I mentioned, the city acquired the site in 2006. We brought on a developer partner, RKM Development, in 2015. Through a competitive solicitation. We've got a number of anchor tenants that have already committed to the project, and I'm going to walk you through what we're doing and where we're going with this. So the development program really focuses on three core areas. The first is food. So when I grew up in Rockwood, we had 7 major chain grocery stores in and around the neighborhood. 6 of them are gone. There's one left. It's actually the most expensive grocery store in all of Gresham. We know that because we had some Portland State University students take a shopping list to all 13 major grocery stores in Gresham, the most expensive grocery stores in the poorest neighborhood that can least afford it. So access to healthy, affordable food is absolutely critical for this neighborhood. And right now, that access is really constrained. A lot of families rely on convenience stores and fast food restaurants to get most of their food access, or they have to drive 4 miles to Winco or even farther to Costco. That's a real challenge for a lot of families in Rockwood. So the first pillar here, first leg of the stool, is really addressing accessibility to healthy, affordable food options. The second piece of it is really hard for me to see from here. Skill building, okay, thank you. We have an economic cluster that is designed to allow folks in the community to take classes to gain the skills that they need to get a living wage job either in the manufacturing sector or in the healthcare sector. So we have a large manufacturing component to Rockwood. 45% of the jobs in Gresham are actually in the manufacturing sector in the Rockwood area. And yet, even though Boeing has 1 million square feet of manufacturing space and John Deere and Pella Windows have all these manufacturing centers, they have positions they can't fill because they can't find skilled labor. At the same time, we have people living below the poverty line. So we need to bridge that gap. And so part of our project is designed to bridge that gap. It's also, the third piece of this is also geared toward supporting small businesses. So we have a number of entrepreneurial people in the community that really would love to open a business, maybe don't have the skills, maybe don't have the capacity, maybe don't have the capital to do so. So lowering those barriers to entry is a really key component to this. So it's really those three core areas that we're trying to focus on to create as much economic opportunity for folks in Rockwood as possible. The path forward, we're in design right now, and I'll show you some of that in a minute. We're expecting to break ground on a $60 million development project on the old Fred Meyer site as soon as August. So this is happening very quickly, or at least it appears to be happening quickly. It doesn't feel quickly for Amy and I, but it's very exciting because it's happening very soon. So what are we doing? We talked about starting with engaging the community. This is a little word cloud that we did. In 2016, we actually had over 50 community engagement events in Rockwood. That's one a week. Some big, rock the block. We had several thousand people, some very small. But as a result, we got some really great feedback from the community. This word cloud is actually from the feedback that we got from over 300 community participants during the annual Rock the Block celebration in June of last year. And if any of you were there, I know Joan, I know you were there, and a number of others were as well. It was a very hot weekend. It was over 100 degrees that weekend. And so the feedback that we got might have been colored a little bit by the temperature. You see water is the biggest word on that word cloud. But I think the common thread here is that people really wanted a place where they could gather, a place to have a place to meet friends, to create a living room for the community that could host farmers markets and concerts and events like Rock the Block, as well as having a place where they can do their weekly grocery shopping, where they can grab lunch, meet a friend, grab a cup of coffee, as well as get access to the resources that they need to gain access to that living wage job or to start that local business. So this feedback was really important for us to think about how to frame the project and the project program. So these are some shots of some of the community engagement events that we did during the year. I'll move through these kind of quickly. The design process, we are toward the end of the design process now. The Gresham Design Commission will be holding a hearing on their last hearing on the land use application and the proposed design for the project later this month. I think it's actually next week. And then once that's approved, we go into construction document production, and we should be in for permits early to midsummer. So this is, again, moving quickly. So the master plan. So this is an overhead shot of the project looking from the east toward the west. The street you see in the foreground there is 187th Avenue. If you recall the old Rockwood Community Office building where the police department used to be in Rockwood, that's sort of right below where the camera would be. Looking west, that's the old Fred Meyer site. And on the left, you see an office building, and I'll describe what that is in a minute. In the center is a market hall with about 30 food vendors all under one roof. And then on the right, a mixed-use building with housing and ground floor retail. So the programming for this, I mentioned the economic cluster and the skill building. We have a number of anchor tenants that are a part of that. So Mount Hood Community College, the Small Business Development Center, is going to move to this site so that they can serve all of the new businesses, both on the site and in the neighborhood. They're coming with WorkSource Oregon, which is the partnership between the college, WorkSystems Inc., and the Oregon Employment Department. That's where you go to get your career counseling services, your unemployment benefits, your job search services. They will be located in this building, along with MetroEast Community Media. Marty's here today with some of his team. They're a really important tenant for us because they're going to be building a new TV production studio, not to replace the one on Cleveland, but to add to it, as well as a digital innovation lab, thinking of it as a digital makerspace. So if you want to go in and take classes on computers and media equipment, you can do that. You can tell your story in the community and have it broadcast, and really filling the digital divide that exists in Rockwood. Just a side note, Rockwood families don't have great access to computers or the internet. In fact, the wait time at the Rockwood Library, which is the most popular place to get online if you don't have a computer at home, on an average weekday afternoon is over 2.5 hours. And there's only 3 computers. So there's a digital divide in Rockwood we're trying to bridge, and MetroEast is a really important part of that that effort. And then in the center, the market hall. So as I mentioned, we've lost 6 of the major grocery stores in the area. We've tried to bring more in. We actually have had quite a recruiting effort. We've reached out to a number of large grocery stores, including Trader Joe's. They're not coming, so we've decided to take a different approach, which is to empower local entrepreneurs to start local businesses to serve the local community. So the market hall will have a grocery component, and we're thinking 5 to 6 vendors who each make up the major departments of a grocery store, so a meat vendor, a dairy vendor, a bakery vendor, daily home essentials like paper towels and dish soap, as well as a number of prepared food vendors. Prepared food, you go in, it's kind of like a food cart pod under one roof, but with actual built out kitchens and serving areas and so forth. And then finally, the mixed use building on the right toward the north, on the corner of Burnside and 187th, will have the first market rate housing units, apartment units in Rockwood in over 30 years. These are not subsidized, these are not income restricted, these are market rate units, as well as a childcare provider, a health clinic, and a community bank branch. So again, trying to meet some of the basic needs of the community as they relate to how people in Rockwood, you know, go through their daily lives. Unfortunately, too many people in Rockwood are too reliant on check cashing places and need to have a community bank branch that can really meet their needs from a financial services perspective. So we're excited to have Albina Bank as our partner there. So I'll keep going through this a little bit more quickly. This is an overhead view. You can see the 3 buildings and the plaza in the center. The old Rockwood Community Office building is going to be renovated. That'll come in a second phase right on the heels of this, and they'll probably actually all open at the same time. The old Rockwood Community Office building is going to become a tech shop. So think of a maker space where you have an idea for a thing you want to make, either as a hobby or as a business. You can go in, use the CAD-enabled workstations to design your widget. You can use the carpentry lab, the metals fabrication lab, the 3D printers, the laser cutters. All of the manufacturing equipment is there for you to make your thing, and then the Small Business Development Center is there to help you take it to market. On the other hand, not everybody's looking to start a business. So if you are looking to gain access to that living wage job in the manufacturing sector, you can go in and take classes on how to use the manufacturing equipment, work with WorkSource Oregon to get placed into one of those jobs in the manufacturing sector, and it's all for you there in one place. So no matter if you're trying to start a business, or gain access to a living wage job in manufacturing or healthcare, all of the resources that you need are here for you in this place. I mentioned healthcare. We have a healthcare provider that's going to open a new clinic in the project in partnership with Mount Hood Community College. So the college has a medical assistant training program. Their students are going to get rotations in the clinic. And what this does is it opens up a pathway for people in Rockwood out of poverty and into a living wage job in the healthcare sector by serving the healthcare needs of their local community. So that's a really important job creation tool as well as a healthcare delivery service tool as well. So we're really excited about that. The public plaza, I think this is one of the things that everybody gets really excited about. We're actually taking a page out of the Arts Plaza in downtown Gresham in terms of placemaking. So this is gonna be a plaza that's designed to be flexible, that can host big events with 2,000 people or just be a comfortable place to grab a bite for lunch. There'll be three play areas for kids of different age groups. There'll be a couple of splash pads, just like we have in the Arts Plaza in downtown. So on those 100 degree weekends in the summertime, kids have a place to splash around and keep cool and keep themselves entertained while mom and dad grab lunch. This is a view into the plaza from the mixed use building to the north. So you can see it's got a lot of potential for creating a really dynamic place. And I should mention that the office building and the mixed-use building are ringed on the ground floor with ground floor retail. So lots of storefronts, lots of activity, lots of merchandise spilling out onto the sidewalk, cafe tables and chairs and umbrellas and those sorts of things to create a really inviting place. I think that placemaking is really important when we talk about changing the perception of Rockwood. Rockwood has a perception problem. And I think as we start to create places that are attractive, inviting, and feel safe, that perception will start to change. So this is a view from the ground floor looking into the plaza, and again you can see kind of what it will feel like walking through at the ground level. And then I'll talk here about the office building, but first I want to show you, actually I think I've got a little video I'm going to show you, but it might be another slide or two in here. Okay, before I get to the video, a little bit about the office building. So this is looking from the courthouse at 185th and Stark into the project, looking northeast. There's a parking area on the southwest corner, and then you've got the WorkSource Oregon entrance right there on the west end of that office building, and then the market hall to the left. This is the office building, so it's a four-story building, three floors of office over a ground floor retail. And then this is actually a really cool component, and I have to really tip my hat to Marty and his team. They worked very closely with the architecture and design team. The MetroEast community media space in this building is actually going to be on two floors, and a portion of that is a double height space with windows on a garage roll-up door that will roll up in the summertime. It'll be actually a really inviting space up there, but when the garage door is pulled down at night, the windows will turn into a video screen where they can actually broadcast their programming to the outdoors. If you're standing on the plaza, you can look up at the building and actually watch a movie, watch whatever programming MetroEast might be broadcasting. And it's a real great opportunity to have some community events in the evening, movie nights, sporting events, other programming that MetroEast is putting together. So I think this is going to become a really dynamic feature of the project. So I mentioned MetroEast. They actually can't even wait until this building is built. They moved in on a temporary basis into the old Rockwood Community Office Building where the tech shop will eventually go, and have already started delivering programming to the community, teaching classes, digital literacy classes to folks in the community. So I'm going to show you a really quick 90-second video of some of the work that they're doing there, and then I'll continue on.
So we're here out at Rockwood DIY, and our goal is to bridge the digital gap.
So the issue that this program is trying to address is the issue of the digital divide, which refers to the people who don't have the skills and access to technology in order to be full participants in society. Every Thursday night, we show up and they complete 5 weeks of training. And upon completion of this program, they get a free computer from Free Geek. We just spend the night setting up their computers, teaching them how to use the operating system, all of that stuff.
I learned a lot about computers.
Like today, we had the parents and teachers conference, and it's right at the time where the teacher asked us where we had a computer at home. I said, wow, yeah, we just got one.
I mean, the first class last week, we were teaching people how to use a mouse.
and we were doing it in a way that was respectful to them.
We want to make sure that this is a very inclusive environment and welcoming to any person, no matter what their barriers to attending class sessions are.
So a lot of kids come to our workshops because we offer childcare.
Everybody was friendly.
We feel like they're our family.
I want to do something better. I have my chance now.
Yeah, absolutely. And I really want to thank Marty for his leadership. This was really his idea, and his team said, we want to do this, and we don't want to wait until the building is built. We want to start now. And this is the kind of story we need to be telling about Rockwood. This is really impactful stuff to the people on the ground who are living there. And this is quite literally, it's not an exaggeration to say, this is changing lives for people who really are already starting out at a disadvantage. So this kind of stuff, I think, is really what this project is about and why I'm so excited to be working on it with great partners. So I'll just continue, spin through here a little bit. So this is Building B, we call it. This is, I'm sure it'll get a better name at some point. Building B. This is the northern building, the mixed-use multifamily and ground floor retail with the health center, the bank branch, and the childcare. This is actually shot looking from the MAX station into the project. And you can see that it's a five-story building for the most part. There's a podium there on the ground floor. We'll have retail. That corner piece is the only piece of retail. We don't really know what's going to happen with it yet in terms of who's going to go there as a tenant, but it's a great retail corner, so something good will go there. And there'll be a rooftop deck for residents above that, which would be a really cool space. This is a shot from the Rockwood Community Office looking across 187th. Pay no attention to the color scheme on Building B. We're still in the design process, so we don't know what the color scheme is going to look like yet, but it's probably not green and gray. We'll see how it ends up. But in terms of the form, this should give you a pretty good idea. This is a shot looking at some of the play areas on the plaza with the building in the background. So again, trying to create a really dynamic outdoor plaza space. And then this is the market hall. This is the market hall where the 30 food vendors and grocery vendors will all be located under one roof. If you've been in the community for a long time, if you grew up in Rockwood or you've been around a long time, you might recognize that thing above the front door there. That thing that I am actually quite affectionate about is the old satellite restaurant sign. For Rockwood, back in the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, all the way up to when they closed in 2001, was an icon for the community. The satellite restaurant and their sign were all created in 1957 when Sputnik went up, and so there was all the rage around the space age and the space race. So we actually have the old sign, and we're in the process of refurbishing it, and we're going to reinstall it on the site. I think as we look forward into the future of Rockwood, it's really important that we pay homage to the past, that we recognize where we've been. And my hope is that not only can we reinstall that old sign, which has a lot of meaning for folks in the community who've been there a long time, but that we also install a permanent installation, maybe working with the Gresham Historical Society, of the history of Rockwood from going all the way back 100 plus years, so that we know where we've been. Because I think that's really important when you're trying to figure out where you're going. So there's a historical component to this project that I think is really important as well. So you can see the entrance there. Before I go further, you'll notice that on the left and right sides of this building, it's really kind of a building within it's a shell within a shell. The outer shell actually reaches beyond the building proper on both sides, and you can see there are a couple of outdoor corridors there. This is what it looks like inside those corridors. So they actually have seating area, so you can sit outside when the weather's nice. And those restaurants indoors actually have windows that open up to the outside, so they can actually serve customers outside as well. And in the wintertime, these windows will get glazed with some plastic sheeting and outdoor heaters, so you can actually be out there 12 months a year. So this is the inside of the market hall, and I'm really excited about this as well. This is a 40-foot floor-to-ceiling height. It's going to be a large volume, really beautiful wood truss system, and a bunch of vendors, small vendors. We're talking 100 square feet each, different sizes, but as small as 100 square feet, throughout the building with a mezzanine above for seating. So you can kind of get a bird's eye view. You go grab lunch and then you go upstairs and you can have lunch and kind of watch the activity below. And then below grade, there's actually, this is the back loading dock area. It's the prettiest loading dock in Rockwood. below grade, this is a little exercise we did on lighting. So we've got clear story windows, skylights in the roof that will allow a lot of daylight to penetrate into the space. And then below grade, there's under the main floor, there's a commissary kitchen. So a lot of these vendors can go downstairs and use the shared kitchen space to create their food products. There'll be shared coolers and freezers and dry storage. There'll be a small office space for the kitchen manager so that they don't have to go build out a whole kitchen. We talked about lowering the barriers to entry for folks who want to start a business. With the incredible diversity that we have in Rockwood, I think we have an opportunity to have a food ecosystem, food offerings in Rockwood that is completely unique to the Portland metro area, simply because of the diversity that we have. Until recently, we actually had an Uzbekistani restaurant in Rockwood. Imagine what we could do if we're actually, you know, purposeful about and organized about what we're doing. So the opportunity to have some really diverse food offerings here is really strong, but we also know that the folks who would start those businesses don't have a lot of capital to start with. So we're giving them the infrastructure as part of the package so that they don't have to spend six figures to build out kitchen space. The kitchen space is included in their rent. These are a couple of schematics of the floors I'll kind of skip through. So where are we? Well, we are very close to the end of the design process. There's a couple more approval steps that we have to go through with the Gresham Redevelopment Commission and with the Design Commission. But we're anticipating a groundbreaking late this summer and a 14-month construction schedule, so opening in fall of 2018. And so I'll close there and before Brad jumps in, if there's any questions, I'd be happy to take one or two now, and maybe I can end. Okay, great, perfect. All right, thank you all, appreciate it.
Good afternoon, I'm Brad Ketch. I'm gonna invite Lynn Ketch from the Rockwood CDC to also join me up here. You'll see, I think we brought enough of the annual reports. It's just a review of some of the things that we've been up to at the Rockwood CDC. It's changing very very quickly, so you're forgiven if you can't keep up. We can't keep up either. We're gonna try to focus out of a lot of stuff that we're doing, focus really how the work of the Rockwood CDC ties to what you just heard. The fact is that great community development projects like this sometimes end up building dead buildings. We want to make sure we're building live buildings, and with the Gresham Redevelopment Commission team helping us, we're working today to bring this community along so that as these buildings open up, the community is actually positioned to take advantage of it. It's not just this project either, though. The Reynolds School Board had a $168 million bond that passed last year, and they're in the process of upgrading or even building brand new buildings. And then the other half of my existence, the Sunrise Development Team, is building about a $35 million project within a stone's throw of this project that you just heard all about. I'm not going to talk about that project today, but together, over $250 million is being spent in the Rockwood Center in the next 2 years. So that's a lot of zeros. And the question is this going to actually benefit our neighbors, or is this going to roll over our neighbors? And I think that today, the answer is, sadly, that community is not positioned to benefit from all of this development. So what can we do now and in the future to create pathways so that our neighbors can participate and also protect and hold open space so that as they come along at their speed, they're able to benefit? So that's really what the Rockwood CDC is all about. We're trying to work with our neighbors to help make Rockwood a place where everyone can learn, earn, and belong. So Lynn Ketch is a board member, a co-founder with me, and also full-time director of wellness initiatives. And Lynn really operates all of our civic engagement work, our Rockwood Speaks, our Rockwood Knocks, and Rockwood Listens. And Lynn, I'd just like to ask if you could give folks an update on Rockwood Speaks, which I think at this point we've talked to over 1,600 of our neighbors in a facilitated conversation over the last 3 years.
Okay. So The idea behind Rockwood Speaks is to have conversations with the people who actually live there, find out what they think about their community, and that and invite them into more detailed conversations around development, networking and connecting them with others in the community who are the oftentimes the decision makers, and letting those two groups hear from one another and exchange ideas, and then over time build the capacity in those community members to be part of boards and action groups and advisory teams. And so that is really the backbone of the Speaks process, is start just by doing conversations at a local apartment complex, meeting those who are invested in the community and planning to stay. There is a 30% turnover rate in Rockwood quite a bit of the time. So identifying those who are stable enough to stay in Rockwood and participate in advisory teams, and that's where our community liaisons came from. They are members of the broader community who are invested in Rockwood, and they're networked and able to attach the project to those that are in the community. They speak the same language, they have similar life experiences, and they become coaches to the members of the community. So that's the Speaks.
Because we're attentive to and responsive to the voice of the community, we sort of get our ideas about what to do to build the community straight from them. One of the things I hear often about the Rockwood CDC is a compliment about how creative we are. And the truth is, we aren't creative. What we've done is we've created an environment where creative people can find a voice. And so they've been telling us what they're ready to do. And I think I'll just start with food systems. Josh touched on it. Indeed, the city's building an environment where people can get to market. But we're working with those perspective makers right now. And what we've learned is they are a long ways away today from being ready to occupy those spots. Now, they can get ready in a hurry. So we're optimistic and confident that local makers will occupy spots. But most of the 40 or so that we've identified today as being prospective makers really should be characterized as pre-entrepreneurial. They're really back at the I make the best tamales you ever tasted. Everybody tells me I'd open a restaurant, and so I think I will. Well, that doesn't mean you're ready to open a restaurant, of course, and it doesn't in any of our cultures. So what do we do today? And we've started at the Rockwood CDC, the Sunrise Center Kitchen. The kitchen is a commissary kitchen. It has, we'll say, 10 makers right now and growing. These are all people who are from our neighborhood. If they're not from our neighborhood, they have to pay more to use the kitchen. If they're from our neighborhood, they pay less. We also have a small fund that generous donors have given us so that we can make it free for a couple of months for somebody to start the kitchen. And they're making products now from 7 or 8 different languages. What we discovered recently is that we were serving it all at all the events, public events at the Sunrise Center Kitchen, and people are kind of going nuts about how good all of this handmade, culturally relevant food is coming out of this kitchen. So we're starting to get catering requests to bring it out. We've just done 2 major jobs. If any of you here are thinking that you're ready for a break beyond little sandwiches, come talk to me, please, because we'll put Tibetan, Mexican, Russian, all sorts of great foods on your table, African-American, pulled pork. You get the idea. We'll serve the world to your table, and happy to do it, because this really does help build our makers. The second thing that we're doing at the Sunrise Center to help people in economic development is we now have a co-working space. Are you familiar with the phrase co-working space? It's where you can rent a cubicle by the week or the month or an office. And we just, due to a generous donation from MBank, as they closed their Lake Oswego office, we now have the whole upstairs of the Sunrise Center full of beautiful cubicles and new office equipment that is being snapped up by our neighbors who need to start creating businesses but can't really do it out of their apartments. We're matching them with CEO coaches or leadership coaches. If any of you here would love to come alongside an emerging entrepreneur and just help him or her. You don't have to be brilliant. You just have to help them take the next step. We'd be happy to connect you with one of our neighbors. What are you ready to jump in on?
Well, I think I'm going to correct you. I think it's Riverview.
Well, it was Embank Branch right. that closed.
But
and
Riverview,
it's now Riverview
is the one who.
Thank you, Kathy.
Thank you.
Or whoever it was.
Yeah. Great cost.
Yeah, thank you. I think one of the things that you hopefully are hearing is I'm going to bring up the word proximity. It's about being close to people. That's where you are most able to connect. So think back when you first were mentored, or whether it was in school or in your business or in college, that somebody came alongside of you and mentored you. That is really the theme of what we're doing at the Rockwood CDC, is connecting members of the broader community who are thriving with those who desire to thrive. And so it's that mentoring process. And many of you, I'm sure, know Jack at Friends of the Children, and then there's the, as soon as I start to do a list, I go blank. The one that's at the city,
Family
and Friend, thank you. And then Faithful Friends. There's several mentoring for youth. Well, we're also interested in mentoring the adults and the whole family in that, again, not so much the Rockwood CDC doing the programming, we're convening a proximity conference towards the middle of summer, where we're inviting those who already do mentoring and those who have models that they're talking about within the government and within the faith community, and having them meet together and share those models and talk about what might work or what needs to be adapted for the Rockwood community.
So in just our last couple of minutes, I'm going to make a pitch. Is that okay? We're a nonprofit. We're growing and struggling, just like every nonprofit that I'm sure many of you generously support. We do invite you to connect with us. We've talked about a couple things so far. We talked about CEO coaching or mentoring. We've talked about becoming a customer of ours for the catering business. We also have opportunities and need, really, for folks to join various steering teams and leadership teams who have expertise to offer our neighbors. There are, I think, I don't know, five or six of them right now that are all volunteer driven, that are making decisions on behalf of and with the Rockwood community. And then finally, we're looking for donors who can make a difference. The whole entrepreneurial development program, including the kitchen, is still looking for about $15,000 to $20,000 in this calendar year, out of a total lift, by the way, of over $110,000. So we're just about there, and we're able to grow this program with what we have. But what we really need next is we need an additional part-time staffer who will join, who will keep the wheels going. So we have a lot of great creativity and a lot of things that we've meshed together, but we really lack the staff capacity to just do a quality job, going at the speed of our neighbors who typically don't speak English or struggle in that area. So you get the idea, is we can't just throw open the doors and hope that great things happen. We have to make sure that we've got staffers and trained volunteers. And, you know, that's really where the cash part comes in. So I wanted to mention that to you. If that's something that's of interest, there's information in the back of the annual report, and I'll also be hanging around for a few minutes. So I'm just going to conclude now, unless there's, are we good? No, stay up here for questions. I'd like to invite Josh up too, because I think probably between the GRDC and the Rockwood CDC, we probably have an interaction between our staff and his staff every day.
Pretty much.
So if one of the three of us can field it, we'd be happy to. And just in conclusion, we do believe that Rockwood is going to be a national story, and it's not just about the great buildings, it's about what is being built into the lives of our neighbors, with our neighbors right now, I think is as equally powerful as anything that's happening. So thank you.
Okay, it's time for questions. I need to, sorry. I stand corrected. I might have misunderstood. Brad, when you first got up to speak, were you encouraged by what's going on with the redevelopment? But it's not enough, or it's not the right thing, or I may have missed a sentence or two in your explanation.
You might have heard exactly right. We're struggling. Our board, the GRDC, the Gresham City Council, everyone is struggling, because community development efforts of this scope have great benefits, and they also have great problems. The benefit, of course, is creating a brand new economic environment in a community like Rockwood. The problem is that most of the time on a national basis, projects like this end up wiping out the poor, and they have to move on to somewhere else, just to be quite blunt. And we have examples in Portland that have gone on for decades. In fact, the reason that Rockwood is Oregon's poorest community is because the city of Portland wiped out opportunities for the poor in the last several decades, and they came to Rockwood. And what we all have to continue to do is to be intentional about not letting that happen again. If we don't continue to focus on this and sharpen our policies, both at a city and a regional level, it will happen. We're already seeing rents rise, homes rise. We're already seeing land being snapped up by out-of-region developers. All of the indicators are in place for one more wipeout. There is time. There is time and there is hope, but we're all very concerned about it.
Yeah, if I can add to that. One of the I talked about economic opportunity as one of the primary goals of our project. I think it's fair to say, you know, we've got, as Brad mentioned, we've got a number of people in Rockwood and in Gresham who have been pushed this direction because of gentrification in Portland. We are trying to learn from the mistakes of what's gone on that in that little community to the west of us by not repeating those mistakes. And what that means is we don't want to gentrify the area and push poor people out. Our project, we could have put in wine bars and expensive condos and those sorts of things. The development program for our project is really geared toward creating opportunities for people who don't have them right now, so that as the community revitalizes, as it starts to improve, they can afford to stay in the community because their personal financial situation has improved. If they take advantage of even some of the economic opportunities presented in our project, their financial conditions will change, and they can break that generational cycle of poverty. That's what we're trying to achieve with our project. Yeah, the buildings are fancy and nice and well-designed. That's great. But this is not a project about buildings. It's a project about people and keeping them in the community by giving them a pathway out of poverty. That is the main goal of the project. So it's revitalization without displacement. And I think that's a really key difference between what we're doing in Rockwood and what we've seen in other parts of the region.
Thank you both for that clarification. All right, questions. My former boss, Warner.
Thank you. So what do you think your time frame is to accomplish this? It just seems to me that there's a time frame to reach critical mass. And that time frame requires money and patience and a lot of diligent effort. So what's your schedule?
That's a great question. Thank you, Warner. The citizens of Gresham passed urban renewal in 2003. It took 5 years to even get that done. So we're already into this 20 years. This is probably the most visible part of the effort, but it's really built on the foundation of work that's gone on really over the last 20 years. I am under no false pretense that Rockwood Rising is going to solve all of Rockwood's problems. It's not, and it shouldn't try to. That's an unrealistic burden to place on any one effort. It's the first step. Actually, it's about the fifth step, but it's a very large step. And I think as we go forward, the city just acquired the 2 acres across the street. That's phase two. Our developer partner already owns a site right next to Rockwood Rising. That's phase three. Actually, phase 1A is the work that Rockwood CDC is doing. They've got 3.5 acres that they're developing now, first building breaking ground like after lunch, pretty much. So I think this is an incremental step. It's a big step, but there are a number of steps that we've already passed and a number of steps still to come. When will critical mass come? Hard to say, but I can tell you right now, 5 years from now, when you drive down Burnside through the heart of Rockwood, it's going to look very different. It will take longer for the socio-economic underlying challenges to really have a paradigm shift than it will take to build the buildings. But I think we're turning around Oregon's poorest neighborhood is kind of like turning around the Queen Mary. It's going to take a while. But these are important steps to get there. And I think I'm hopeful that the people who come after us will build on the work that we're doing now, just the way that we're building on the work of the people that were putting this whole idea of revitalization in Rockwood together 10, 20 years ago.
I'm partly teasing, but the light at Stark and Burnside is awful. I hope that gets fixed.
It's horrible.
I mean, you have to sit there for hours, and Max comes one way, it's your turn to go, and then Max comes the other way, and it's not your turn to go. And anyway, it's been a bone of contention for me. Yeah, I'll take the Max. Yeah, right. Yes, right. All right, Haley.
Hi. I grew up actually in Northeast Portland and inner Northeast Portland, and I'm seeing a lot of my friends and people who are from the area moving further out because of affordability reasons, and if they want to buy a house, we're looking at, you know, where we can afford them. So are you concerned that people are going to move out before you can really start making these significant changes in the community that's already there?
Yes.
Okay.
Let me give you a couple of data points about the threat of the Portland market, which is overheated, finding a natural place to land and driving Rockwood out. And the first data point is in the business community. So Reynolds School District, $168 million bond, very significant commitment by that board to using minority, woman, and emerging small business contractors. Hats off to them. Way more than required by law. A significant commitment. And they asked us and others to help them find those MWESB qualified contractors in the Rockwood area or Gresham area. And we had an MWESB event called Meet and Certify. So using the Sunrise Center, I think the first time we had over 150 people show up. They were there to find out how to either get MWESB certification, or if they already were, how to connect to the procurement department of Reynolds School District. Afterwards, when we analyzed where all these businesses came from, where'd they come from? They came from Portland. They were all Portland-based businesses. They were very few from the communities of color. They were woman-owned, which is great, but we have communities of color in Rockwood. There were two, and neither were qualified even to attain MWESB business. So it was kind of a wake-up call. Ditto with home values. So really it's and the calls that we get for the Sunrise Center kitchen and for the co-working space are typically established white businesses from Portland who are recognizing Rockwood as being the next emerging market and are trying to get in early so they can establish their brand. So we've got to protect space for our neighbors to come along at the pace that they're going to come, or else we will not achieve these goals. And we're doing that.
Another question? Okay, Sue, here I come.
Well, I think one of the important things is actually to talk about housing and how we find the opportunities to keep the people that live here being able to still move up as well. So the project that you're ready to break ground, how many units are going to be there? And then after that, what's the first building that's going to go up there on the Catalyst site? So two different questions.
Yeah, so let me take the housing one first. I think the housing question is really important. I'll give you another statistic. In Rockwood, the median home price in the last 6 years has almost doubled. That's happening whether any of this development happens or not. And that's a function of what's happening in Portland, pushing people out. So obviously we're very concerned about that. We're not gonna be able to stop those economic changes. What we can do though is control what we can control and create the opportunities that allow people to be able to afford the neighborhood when it starts to go up in value. So in terms of housing, as I mentioned, the housing component to our project is the first market rate multifamily in Rockwood of any scale in over 30 years. It's market rate, it's not income restricted, it's not quote unquote affordable, at least in the technical sense of low income housing tax credits. The goal here though is to create a mix of housing types in Rockwood. One of the 8 goals that the citizens of Gresham passed as part of the Urban Renewal Charter is a mix of housing types. And right now, we really don't have a great mix. We have a whole bunch of intentionally affordable and unintentionally affordable housing. And by unintentionally affordable, I mean kind of run down and not that great. So if people take advantage of some of these opportunities with the Small Business Development Center and the digital makerspace, the physical makerspace, WorkSource Oregon, and they're able to get into a living wage job, there's no housing in Rockwood that's appropriate for them. And so what are they going to do? They're going to take their new middle income wealth and move out of the community, which will further concentrate poverty in Rockwood. So we have to have a mix so that we can keep people of all different strata of income in the community. That creates a healthier community. So I often get asked, so how come you're not including affordable housing when we have a housing crisis? Actually, I think we have to look at it more holistically and recognize that the city of Gresham has actually put dollars, CDBG and home dollars and other dollars into the creation or preservation of much more affordable housing units in Rockwood and in Gresham than will be built in this project. So this is actually really the first step that the city's making of creating housing that's not income restricted, 60% MFI and below. So it's really about trying to create a mix. So in terms of your second question, our project is really breaking ground all at the same time. What you'll see is a groundbreaking of Building B first, and then a couple months later, the other two and the plaza. They'll all finish up about the same time, though. The Rockwood Community Office building will start 6 to 8 months later because that's just a renovation and a pretty light one. That should finish all at the same time. So in the fall of 2018, I would like to invite you all to come to our ribbon cutting, knock on wood. That's when we're planning to have all four buildings operational at that point.
And your project, Brad?
So I'm going to jump in on the data point that we collected this last holiday, the end of the December 31st, we did Rockwood knocks, and about 1,800 doors were knocked on, and surveys, 600 surveys were collected, and 40% of those indicated on the survey that they were, one of the questions asked, are you planning to move, and what is the reason given, and 40% said they could afford better. And that's people living along the max line in apartment complexes. That was where we targeted the survey. So that means that we have a population living in Rockwood that is looking for workforce housing. And so I'll let you answer.
Oh, yeah, our focus here today really is on the Rockwood CDC and the Gresham Redevelopment Commission. But there is, as you've indicated, another project that has similar design goals and will look very similar because we're all building off of the Rockwood design book that the city requires. Just to give you a feel for that design book, it is above Pearl District level quality. And that's something that the citizens of Gresham require. Ours is gonna look really beautiful too. It's the first building is breaking ground, like Josh said, imminently, and will be 44 apartment units, larger ones. You know, we have large families in Rockwood, so these are 3-bedroom, 2 baths at market rate. A Head Start is going to be in the first floor. Most of the Head Start qualified families in the entire Portland metropolitan area live here. So they're ready to expand. So we're going to have lots of little kids running around our area. There's 4 buildings on the campus that we'll ultimately be building. The second will mirror the first, and then the third one will be a little bit of commercial. The fourth will be an educational building. So if you or anybody you know is going to be thinking about education expansion in the next couple of years, this is a 57,000 square foot, three-story building. It'll basically look like the new courthouse. And that purpose of that is for education.
We have time for 2 more questions. Kathy, here comes the microphone.
I can talk pretty loud.
Not cute.
Okay. So, Brad, on the Head Start, I'm curious, is that from Reynolds School District or a private Head Start?
So Head Start's a federal program, and Mount Hood Community College is the holder of that program for our area. And they currently, their footprint is the Head Start footprint, so it starts all the way over in the Park Rose District and goes all the way to Mount Hood. And they're seeing this demand. So the first 10,000 square foot that we open up will be an expansion, and then the second 10,000 will likely be closing a couple of smaller locations that unfortunately don't meet health department code.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Did you have a question?
Marty has one. Marty just likes to talk. He doesn't really have a question.
Oh. What does he do to deserve that?
He's getting slammed. In all of the great work that's gone into the Rockwood Rising and the organic thrive-in-place model, have you seen anywhere in the country that you can pull from, and maybe this is more so Josh, to play off that parable, teach a person to fish as opposed to, you know, providing fish? Where can we look to get some inspiration to sort of fast-track people into economic vibrancy? Is there any hope out there? Is there any, I mean, this is a very hopeful project, don't get me wrong, that's why I'm so excited to support it, but thinking about individual people and their households and my own family and the experience I had of, you know, having to shut my business down after the crash in 2008 and how easy it was for me to rebound because of my training and education and skills and support, I'm just hoping that there's something. I just had a conversation with my 86-year-old aunt on the way over here, and she said, quitting isn't in my blood, it's not in yours either. You know, it's something that I think is true in Rockwood. How can we help the people really jumpstart into their own ownership?
It's a great question. There's kind of two questions in there. I think the first question in terms of, is there some model that we're following? The short answer is no. I mean, really the model we're following is to say, go listen to the community and find out what they need and then bring partners to the table that can help fill in some of those gaps. And you're one of those. So I think we're creating the model. We're not following somebody else's model that works somewhere else. We're creating the model that others are going to follow. And I'm actually really proud of that, because as people in Gresham, we do things our own way, and we figure it out, and we create what we need to create a better lives for ourselves. So this is really a project that has germinated from the community, and the shape that it's taken is not some genius on our part. It's really the genius of the community saying, this is the kind of place we need, this is the kind of opportunities we would like to have, and if we're looking out 5 years, 10 years, this is the kind of place that we want to that we would feel proud to be a part of. And so it's really been about bringing people together. In terms of creating opportunities, I think that bringing partners together part is where the wraparound services and the greater than the sum of our parts component of this really comes from, because it's really tough for one person on their own to try to figure out the path. You layer onto that somebody who's not born in this country, maybe doesn't speak English as their first language, economic challenges as well, and it becomes very hard to sort of chart your path. And that's why it's so important to have organizations like the Rockwood CDC and like all of the other partner organizations in Rockwood who each bring a piece of the puzzle, so that somebody stepping in to any one of those pieces has access to the whole pie. And so it's really about a coordinated community effort to try to create sort of a social ecosystem that supports people no matter what their needs are. I may not be able to solve your need, but my friend over here can at this organization. So we're gonna work together to make sure you get what you need. That's really the support system that that holds the whole thing together. And you know, you talk about urban renewal projects generally nationally. We started out without two nickels to rub together to make a project happen, but we had the most important thing. The most important thing that we had as an asset was a community that was tightly knit together and all in on seeing positive change. You can't buy that. That's absolutely critical. And that's really the special sauce that makes the whole thing work.
And I just have to say, as I watched the video of the DIY, I recognize half those people. They live in Rockwood. That's who they. I know what apartment complex they live in. I know who knows them and knows them. I mean, that we're networked, and that's what I'm inviting you to do, is to find a way. Start in your. I always do this. Start in your own community, your own neighborhood, and make sure you know your neighbors. Because that's really what we're asking Rockwood to do, is we're asking Rockwood to get to know their neighbors so that they're not disconnected. And we're inviting you to participate in getting them to know the broader community. Because as business people, you know what networking is.
Networking is important. That's a good segue, Lynn. Great name. Do we spell it the same?
Yeah.
We do. If we build it, they will come, maybe. maybe not. I'm going to make a suggestion. As you put up the gorgeous buildings, which are an amazing investment on both parts, you need to start planning of how to get people there that are not just next door neighbors that may or may not stay for a long period of time. So, just as a thought, how do we get folks that live here or in Sandy or Troutdale or any of the outlying areas into the neighborhood of Rockwood, not Rockwood itself?
Have you had our tamales?
Well, yes, I have, as a matter of fact, and I still have heartburn from it, but not because they were bad, it's because of my stomach. No, I'm suggesting you have a free concert with Bruce Springsteen and Neil Diamond, and just bring everybody that you can into that neighborhood to introduce them to how safe it is, the new buildings, because there are a lot of people that avoid coming. They drive around. We need to have a marketing plan of how to get people into that area. I have a little experience with that. So
excellent.
Fix the light at Stark and Burnside so they can get there. And then have something big. Have a really good marketing plan of how to get folks re-exposed, reintroduced to the area. And it won't be because of a 100 square foot area that somebody's selling fresh food. It's got to be bigger and more impressive than that. So anyway, last question. Any other question? Let's give them a huge round of applause for giving up their time. When I said giving up your time, I meant reorganizing your time to join us at the Chamber of Commerce. We are partners in this as well. So I want to thank you all for coming today. I want to thank again Portland General Electric, Riverview Bank, Gresham Barlow School District, MetroEast Community Media. Be sure and pick up your flyer so that you can remind yourself of everything you heard today if you're over 50 or 60 or whatever. You may need to hear things twice. You can watch it and listen to it again. The rebroadcast replay times are on the registration table as you leave. Next month, we have Ruth Miles here. Ruth Miles is a Gresham treasure that happens to work for the state of Oregon. And she is an amazing woman that knows everything about business. She doesn't live too far from here, and she's going to come and help us. We've had her before. She's phenomenal. And her topic is Oregon's economy, a race to the top. So please take a moment to fill out the evaluation forms. As you know, we give a free trip away to Hawaii every month for those that have filled the forms out. Not. We don't do that. All right, one last story, and then we're going to wrap up. my grandson, was turning 10. Maybe I've shared this story with you before, but he was turning 10, and he was having his first sleepover, and we were on our way in the car together to an event, to a recording studio, actually, and he was telling me about the trip, about his sleepover, and he was so excited, and I said, well, how many kids are coming? And he says, well, only two have said yes so far, Grandma. And I said, oh, really? And I could tell he was disappointed by that. And I said, well, Grandma will come. I'll bring my red sleeping bag, and I'll sleep outside with you. And the car, the air in the car got sucked out. He was so scared that I was going to come and invade his very first sleepover. And he said, well, Grandma, I think you're overqualified. With that, all the rest of you overqualified people have a wonderful day, and those that aren't overqualified and are underqualified have a wonderful day too. Thank you for being here.